that never ends. That kind of fellowship, wow, that's so wonderful. Fellowship is one of the most beautiful privileges and graces of the Christian experience. Fellowship, koinonia. You know, it can lift a person out of depression, and it certainly can lift a person out of isolation, but it also introduces people into a life of caring and sharing. That kind of love of God, unstoppable love of God. And you know, one of the primary purposes of life, as I'm quoting from the pastor, one of our pastors in our nation, a wonderful Christian leader named Rick Warren in The Purpose-Driven Life, he said, in the second purpose of our life, I was planned for God's family to fellowship with his people, and so I will use this day to show love to other believers. Let me say that again. I was planned for God's family to fellowship with his people, and so I will use this day to show love to other believers. Well, what kind of fellowship are we to have? What does it look like? Paul, in his letter to the Philippians, in the New Testament book of the Philippians, talks about that crucial need for fellowship in our communion with God, and especially in our relationships among fellow believers. Today we are looking at Philippians chapter 2, if you would turn with me in your Bibles, where Paul describes three keys to fellowship that we must pursue. Now, by way of analogy, I usually carry three keys with me. A lot of you probably carry at least three keys, maybe or more. One of the keys, of course, would be for our home, where we live, our place of stay. Another key might be for your vehicle, so you can have some transportation to your place of work or business. And then the other key would be either for your office, your place of business, or maybe for the outfit, the equipment that you run, and you've got to have that. So probably at least three keys. I noticed the one that we have. And by the way, thank you so much for all your warm welcome. And the place that you provided for us is awesome. And we want you to call us up, stop by, visit us sometime. And I have a key for that place, but it's kind of new. I have a new key. So sometimes when you use a key, the key needs to be broken in. No pun intended there. But sometimes the key, you know, not the place broken in, but the key needs to be broken in. You know, it needs to be used. And maybe that is the way sometimes in our fellowship. Sometimes we just need to work at it. We need to develop, cultivate our relationships and our fellowship in order to become more and more open, so to speak, with one another and be able to open up. So Paul talks about that here in Philippians chapter 2 about these keys to fellowship. And the first key he talks about is the key of unity. And so if you'll follow with me, I'd like to read the scripture, Philippians chapter 2, beginning with verse 1. This is what he says. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. The first key of fellowship is that key of unity. We are to pursue a spirit of unity. And Paul describes this unity here in four basic realities. If you look at the text closely in verse 1, he says the first reality is that of encouragement. The word is parakalesis. Para, as you know, means to be called alongside of. Some of you may be involved like paraprofessional in your kind of work. You're a paraprofessional. Well, you're called alongside of to help. And kaleo, the word from call, to be called, and you're called alongside of, but to give that kind of encouragement, and it's from being united with Christ. The New Testament word for that word encouragement is closely also related to a word that is used of the Holy Spirit, the paraclete, the comforter, the counselor, the encourager. The word is also used of exhortation in the sense of either rebuke or comfort. In the context here, leans toward the idea of comfort as it is expressed. Every believer has received this work of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, and it comes from that overflow of our union with Christ. And you and I know that encouragement goes a long way to enhance that spirit of unity. But that's just one reality. Here's a second reality of this key to unity. And is the word comfort. Paul goes on to say, if there's any comfort from love. The word comfort is based on the knowledge and assurance of God's love that is demonstrated in Christ, of which we're going to remember today in our communion together. The fact of Christ dying for our sins and giving us the gift of eternal life. God's people. The love of God in the hearts of God's people produces spiritual unity in their lives. And that's a reality. There's a third reality. And that's the word for fellowship proper, the word koinonia, which Paul uses here. If there is any, not only comfort from love, but any, in the ESV, it's the word participation, partnership, fellowship. It is fellowship within and by or with the Holy Spirit. The prepositions there can use either in or with the Spirit. It is the result of the Spirit's indwelling ministry that he's given to us. This fellowship, we must understand, comes from the Holy Spirit, and it is that Spirit of God who indwells each believer, and he is the one who produces it. That's a third reality. And then there's one more Paul talks about, and that's at the end of verse 1. He says, if there is any affection and sympathy, or the word might be translated as empathy, any affection or compassion is another word, tenderness. You see, one of the Spirit's ministry is to produce within each believer a concern and a love for other members of God's family. And this concern and love may be received or may be rejected. We don't know how people are going to respond to us sometimes. And we need to leave the results up to God. But we need to do what he's called us to do. And that work of the Spirit is still, though, the reality, and it is the basis for spiritual unity. So we have these realities of encouragement and comfort and participation, and then that tenderness or compassion. All of these make up that first key of fellowship, the key of unity. But Paul does not stop there. As you go on and look at verse 2, He actually here now exhorts the Philippians to apply these realities by being in verse 2, he says, complete my joy by being of the same mind, being like-minded. Keep in mind, like-mindedness does not necessarily mean uniformity. Not necessarily uniformity in thought. You know, we may not always agree with each other on every point. But God has made us, of course, with different personalities, and we have different backgrounds. For the Philippians, remember how Paul started this church? Do you remember the makeup of the different people? There was the businesswoman, Lydia. Wow. They met in her home. And then there was the slave girl, the servant girl. And then there was the town jailer in his family. Look at the diversity of people that came together, and yet they had such unity and oneness because they knew Christ. So like-mindedness does not necessarily mean that, you know, we always agree with everything or uniformity of thought, but it does mean that we should try to work together in serving Him. We are to still pursue unity even in the midst of diversity, as did the people of the church at Philippi. And Paul encourages him in that way. And he goes on to say in verse 2 that we must apply these realities by maintaining the same love, being united in spirit, that's of one soul and one accord, and being of one mind and one purpose. In essence, Paul is saying that if they would clear up their... Now, here's where things are beginning to surface. This is a wonderful, wonderful church at Philippi. And that's why I love to read and study Philippians, because I'm so encouraged by it. It's one of my favorite books of the Bible, if I could have one. I've got some Old Testament favorites too, a lot of passages, but this is really a favorite in the New Testament. And he talks and he surfaces something here. Something is surfacing. He's saying that if we would, the believers here at Philippi, if they clear up their petty quarrels, if they work together in harmony by practicing these things he just talked about, they would then cap off his joy. They would make his joy complete. His joy would be made full. And God wants us to have that kind of, he wants us to pursue. We're not perfect, but we can trust God to work through us to pursue, at least pursue, take steps in that direction, to pursue a spirit of unity. That's a spirit, such a spirit, that is very key and vital for quality fellowship. The first key of fellowship, the key of unity. Paul doesn't stop there. He goes on in verse 3 to talk about the second key of fellowship, and that's the key of consideration. The key of consideration. Paul calls us to pursue a spirit of consideration. Verse 3, he says, do nothing from rivalry or conceit, but in humility count others as more significant than yourself. And let each of you look not only at his own interest, but also at the interests of others. It's interesting, the terms that Paul uses here reveal an underlying problem in the church at Philippi. There was some self-centeredness. A church as wonderful as this? Yeah. There was some self-centeredness among certain of the believers. And so Paul exhorts them to overcome it. Negatively, he says that nothing was to be done out of selfish ambition, that is, out of rivalry, selfish motives. But moreover, he says, nothing was to be done out of empty conceit, which can be translated as simply vain glory. Vain glory. This was probably the root cause of their selfish ambition in the early church at Philippi. Some of them were, well, let's face it, he said they were conceited. They wanted to glory in themselves. And Paul exhorts them to overcome that kind of selfish motives and that empty conceit. Such negative behaviors, he says, those are mortal enemies of unity and harmony in the church. They cause damage to the keys of fellowship. They actually damage the key. And Paul is encouraging them tenderly to make the course corrections there as they need to. So how is one really to overcome these negatively? Well, positively in verse 4. Positively, Paul says that in humility, here's how to do it. In humility, he says, look at, show concern, show consideration for the interests of others. You see, Paul had already demonstrated this himself. You know it as you study chapter 1. Paul set the example. He demonstrated this by himself, by his willingness to stay on for the sake of the Philippians. Chapter 1, verse 24. And so now he exhorts them to consider others before themselves, just like he had been doing. If they would do this, he said, they would go far in removing the disharmony that they were experiencing. So Paul calls upon them to shore up this key of consideration for others. And then there's more. Yes, he talks about a third key to fellowship. Not only the key of unity and the key of consideration, but thirdly, he talks about the key of humiliation. Paul calls upon us to pursue that spirit of humiliation. Here Paul turns to the example of Christ in verse 5. Have this attitude in yourselves, which is also in Christ Jesus. And then he goes on and talks about how Christ demonstrated that kind of humility in verses 6 to 8. How Christ is the supreme example of humility and selfless concern for others. Verse 6, he says, who, though he was in the form of God, he did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he made himself nothing, taking the form of a servant and being born in the likeness of men and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross. This is one of the great passages about Christ in the New Testament, in fact, in all the Bible. It's a story of Christmas. Did you realize this is a Christmas story that we're talking about here? But it's also a story beyond Christmas to the story of Easter. And even more than that, it's a story, well, of Thanksgiving, which is so appropriate for this time of the year for us here. Thanksgiving. But it's something, it's a story for all year round. Paul exhorts the believers here to have that same spirit of Christmas, that same attitude as Easter, that thanksgiving and appreciation, that same selfless humility that was exhibited here by Christ. You realize that when the fullness of time came, God sent forth his Son. That's why he came. You know why Christ came? John tells us in his gospel, Jesus, before Pilate, was telling him, for this reason I came into the world. This is why I was born, and this is why I'm born, and this what for this reason I came into the world. It was to testify of the truth. What's the truth? Luke tells us why Jesus came. He came to seek and to save that which was lost. Mark, in his gospel, tells us that the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. So how was that spirit of humility demonstrated in Christ? What exactly did he do for us? Here's what he did. You know, his favorite title that he gave of himself was the title of Son of Man. That's what Jesus called himself. Servant. Came to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. What did he do? How did he do that? In his incarnation. We're going to be talking more about that as we approach the Christmas season. God incarnate, Christ coming in the flesh. Well, there's a crucial passage in verse 6, and it's the word which we get other words called morphe, but it means form. It means nature. Verse 6, though he was in the form, the nature of God, he did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. The word refers to that outward appearance that accurately reveals the inward nature. That is, this word stresses the very essence, the very reality of Christ. Jesus, Paul is saying here, is the very essence of God. He is God. When Christ became a man, when he took on flesh in his humanity, his incarnation, he took on the very reality of humanity. But in taking on perfect humanity, Jesus still possessed complete and absolute deity. Paul is making that very clear here in the use of his terminology. Paul was carefully stressing this truth. He emphasized that Jesus was and is God, fully God. But what did he do for us? Fully man in his humanity. The text in verse 7 says, he emptied himself. The ESV says that he made himself nothing. That comes from one word. And it's a word that theologians have debated for centuries, but they have come to understand this, what's called kenosis, the word for emptying. What did he empty himself of when in his incarnation? What does this kenosis mean? It means that although Christ possessed full deity, still God, fully God, the fact that he is the Lord God himself, he willingly set aside his full use of all his attributes when he took on human flesh in his incarnation and became a man. In his earthly life, he gave up the independent exercise of his divine attributes in order to obtain his objectives. That is, he still possessed all the attributes of God. But he surrendered his right to use them in all of God's splendor and glory in order to fully accomplish his purposes for coming. As God incarnate, as the God-man, he is fully God and fully man. But in fact, the most, as we mentioned, he preferred that title, Son of Man, which he got from Daniel chapter 7. Regarding coming before the Ancient of Days, and there appeared the Son of Man. Mark 10:45, he came to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. And so the terminology here in verse 8, that he humbled himself by taking on that very nature of a servant, which points to his lowly, humble position. He was willing to obey the Father, God the Father. He was willing to serve others. He became a man, a true human being, but in his humanity, he was different from other people, and that he alone was sinless. Christ was without sin. He did not sin. He had to be sinless in order to be the perfect sacrifice for our sins and to go to the cross. And so the last part of verse 8 here says that he was obedient to the Father, to the point, even to the point of death, even death on the cross. And by the way, that form of capital punishment was limited to non-Roman citizens and to the worst of criminals. Christ died not only for those who were not citizens, but guess what? He also died for those who were citizens. He died for you and for me in our place to pay the penalty for our sins. Yes, Christ humbled himself. He was fully obedient to God the Father, and therefore the text says, verse 9, therefore God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under earth, and that every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The very one whom men despised and rejected, God honored and exalted. The word Paul uses there is literally God super exalted. And in fact, everyone will someday bow in humility and acknowledge him for who he really is. Everyone will do so, either willingly in this life or made to do so in the life to come. Everyone will bow, including the angels and the saints in heaven and those people living on earth and those under the earth, even Satan and all his demons and all the unsaved dead in hell. And Paul says that everyone, what will they confess? He says that everyone will confess in verse 11, they will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. That's what they will confess. They will confess that he is Yahweh God, as talked about in the Old Testament. He is the I am. I am who I am. That's who he is. He is all that he claimed to be, very God of very God. But unfortunately for many, it will be too late in that day for their salvation, for their souls. As C.S. Lewis so aptly put it, he said that in the end, there will be those who say to God, "Thy will be done." And then in the end, there will also be those to whom God will have to say to them, "Thy will be done. Depart from me, for I never knew you." How tragic. Nevertheless, Paul is saying here, all will bow, all will confess him as Lord, and the exalted place that he now occupies, and this future universal bowing and confessing of his lordship is all to the glory of the Father. So Jesus demonstrated that spirit of unity and consideration and humility. He exemplified the kind of attitude that we are to have for the quality of fellowship to take place among his followers. And so now we must continue. We must pursue it toward that. Pursue a spirit of consideration, looking out for the concerns and interests of others. That spirit of unity, encouraging one another. Yes, and even pursuing that spirit of humility, acknowledging the lordship of Christ in our very own lives. These, you see, are really the three keys that are essential to maintain quality fellowship with the kind of fellowship, really, that God desires for all of us in order to build his church and to advance his kingdom. Well, fellowship is enhanced, of course, as we observe all that Christ has commanded us. And it includes the celebration of what we call communion, the Lord's Supper. You know, communion has several different important connotations. Remembering, of course, Christ's work for us, spiritual nourishment, fellowship with the Lord and with his people. And then again, also, and one of my favorites, of course, is the anticipated reunion with Christ in the wedding supper of the Lamb when the Lord returns. Wow. Just think about that. We look forward to that. But this ordinance here, which Jesus has commanded us to observe now in the church age, and for us here today, this ordinance is also referred to as the breaking of bread. Some refer to it as a Eucharist, for example, but don't be afraid of that. Eucharist simply means thanksgiving. Thanksgiving, yeah. So it was out of this, it was actually out of the Last Supper, the Passover Supper, that Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper. And he instructed his followers to observe this ordinance, and that's why the Apostle Paul wrote these words. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' And then in the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" You know, if you are a believer in Jesus Christ, you are welcome to partake of these elements. And parents, by the way, parents, please guide your children. You know, if they're old enough or if they're believers or not, and they understand the meaning of celebrating the Lord's Supper. So I ask that you would guide them. But all of us, of course, need to examine ourselves. Although none of us are perfect, you don't have to be perfect to come here. But Paul does call upon us to examine ourselves. For we come, we realize we're all sinners. Yep, we're all in the same boat. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And we desperately need the Savior. But he invites us to come. Scripture says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so, if you do not know where you are in your relationship with Christ, now would be a very good time to get right with the Lord through turning from yourself and your ways and turning to trust Christ as your own personal Savior and your Lord. I encourage you to do that now, or even if you're not sure. But it would be a good time now. But if you do know that you have a relationship with Christ and you are in fellowship with him, you are certainly encouraged as his followers to partake of the bread and the cup. As our servers were becoming forward now, if you'd come forward, I'd like all of us to quiet our hearts for a moment to reflect just where we are in our relationship and our fellowship with him. Would you bow and let's just pray quietly for a moment, and then I will lead us in prayer. Father, we are so thankful for the bread and the cup, and we do pray that these elements will provide more than physical nourishment, but that you would just grant us the peace and unity and fellowship and the spiritual nourishment that this bread symbolizes. Cleanse us and consecrate again us as we together partake of this bread. Amen. I want you to note that as we are being served the bread here, we would ask that you would hold it until all have been served, okay? And then we'll partake of it together.
Sometimes my faith feels thin, like the night will never end. Will you catch every tear, or will you just leave me here? I have this hope in the depth of my
And Jesus said, "This is my body broken for you. Take, eat this in remembrance of me." Then in the same way, the scripture says that he also took the cup, and after supper, he said these words. He said, "This cup is the covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Once again, if you would hold the cup until all who have been served. Jesus says, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Let's partake together.
As they collect the cups, I'm going to call the gentleman forward. This is the first Sunday of the month, and this gives us the opportunity to give so that we to give to our benevolence fund so that we may be able to help those that are in need from time to time. And it's coming on the Christmas season, the holidays, it gets cold, and we're generally called upon on a more regular basis. And so we thank you at this time for those gifts that we are going to receive that will be directed directly to our benevolence fund. I will pray for this as the gentlemen finish coming forward. Dear Heavenly Father, we know that there are people in need. And with this, at this time, we are called upon to give from our heart so that we are able to assist those that need for whatever reason, whether it's medical or heating, electricity, just paying a bill because they come up short. So Heavenly Father, we ask you that you have us give from our heart to this fund and that we give willingly as we pray for those that are in need. In Jesus' name, amen. While they pass the plate around, I will, there's a few announcements. Of course, first of all, I'd like to welcome, last week we had a general meeting and we welcomed to the board a deacon of Christian education, Judy Borboom, an elder, Mark Huberger, and elder, Kent Williams. If you get a chance to see them, just pray for them, as there's a lot to do here on the board here. We also elected new members, Judy Borboom, Amber Fritke, Mike and Marietta Huberger, Dave and Gay Rupp. If you get a chance to see them or meet with them, actually, if some of you don't know who they are, I'm going to ask those people to please stand. Judy she's in Children's Church. She's working. Amber Fricke, I think she's here. There's Amber. If you get a chance, welcome her to the house. Mike and Marietta Huberger. And go ahead, and there's another couple. And then Dave and Gay Rupp. So give them a chance, greet them, give them a great welcome and stuff. So other announcements, Ron and Sandy are still taking sign-up sheets in the back so they can get to know you. They'd like to sit down and visit with as many couples as they can here in the next month, the 6 weeks, just to get to know you and get to know the church. It all goes in part of their process of gathering information as to choosing the right pastor to lead us in the near future. Remember, there's a couple women's Bible studies. These are all in the bulletin. Please open it up and read it. There's also a men's Bible study that's going on Monday nights. I know we're coming to an end. We look forward to possibly getting another one going. Sunday mornings, we have a small group gathering. You're welcome. Or send your prayers to church. We pray for anybody, for anything, for whatever it is. We gather at 8 o'clock and pray, and you're welcome. So, also in the bulletin, there's a Thanksgiving service we'll be holding here. Please look at that. That's going to be at 6:30 Wednesday night before Thanksgiving. And then Christmas Eve services are in here. Also, there's an opportunity for the young kids. There's a green sheet here. It's a Christmas Eve, or it's a Sunday, December 17th worship service. It is going to be a Christmas program. They're starting to gather information for in getting some kids together to start practicing and getting that going. So if you want the opportunity, it's in there. So with that, the bulletin's very important. I ask you to read it. There's lots of things going on. So thank you again, and I believe Ron's going to close us.
Thank you again. And, you know, my wife, Sandy, would you stand back there? Be sure and sign up if we haven't had a chance to come and visit with you, either at your home or you come to our home, or we can meet here at the church, or we can meet at a neutral place somewhere. That'd be great. We just want to get to dialogue with you and get to know you better. These times have been so rewarding and so enriching for us, and we thank you. So if you haven't had a chance to sign up to spend some time with us, please, with my wife, Sandy, do meet with her afterwards before you leave to sign up. And then last week, our daughter was able to be here from Fargo, bring her little seven-month-old baby boy with her, and today, our son and his wife, Josh and Sarah Lewis, with their three elementary school-age boys, are here with us today. They're from Sioux Falls. So if you get a chance to meet with Josh and Sarah, we're glad for their support and that they could be here today. I just wanted you to know that. So now as you go from here, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit abide and be with you all. Amen. We're dismissed.